So earlier this month, the headlines were going wild over fish oil. A new study suggested omega-3 supplements like fish oil increase the risk of a heart disease called atrial fibrillation. In order to pump blood normally, the heart needs to contract in a really concerted, a really rhythmic way. And so disturbances of that rhythm can cause serious problems. Those disturbances are called arrhythmias, and one type of arrhythmia is atrial fibrillation. So this new study is suggesting that fish oil raises the risk of this type of heart disease. Wait, isn't fish oil supposed to be good for the heart? It sounded really counterintuitive to a lot of people and a bit scary. So it got a lot of headlines and it got a lot of people worried. Now, some people were dismissive of this study. I saw some people on social media saying, well, this is an observational study, an epidemiological study, so it's probably bogus. This probably doesn't happen. And that's not a very wise train of thought to reflexively dismiss observational studies, because while it is true that sometimes epidemiological studies don't pan out as cause and effect, they often do. So what we want to do is dig deeper. We don't want to jump to conclusions. In fact, in this case, the assumption that it's bogus because it's just epidemiology is almost certainly wrong, because we already have randomized trials showing this connection. And actually, we have several large randomized trials with thousands of participants with placebo controls and even meta-analyses that put them together and also find this higher risk of atrial fibrillation with omega-3 supplements. So this is a very high level of evidence. So this effect is almost certainly real. And actually, it's not even news, because we've known about this for years. Okay, so if I take fish oil, it's going to give me heart disease, so I should avoid fish oil then. Well, it's not quite that simple, because how much fish oil are we talking about? What dose of omega-3s? I know some people who reacted to this study pointed to dose. I know Brad Stanfield did, and I agree with him. I think he's probably right that dose is crucial here as well. In fact, there's also a meta-analysis looking at risk of atrial fibrillation on different doses of omega-3 supplements. And basically, they found that higher doses, over 1 gram a day of omega-3s, raised risk of atrial fibrillation by 49%, while 1 gram a day or under raised it less, by 12%. So it's telling us that dose does matter. And even 1 gram a day is still quite a bit higher than what most people take. For example, in the US, the most common dose of over-the-counter long-chain omega-3s like EPA, DHA is 600 milligrams a day, 360 EPA plus 240 DHA. So 600 milligrams is around half of 1 gram, a little over half. 500 would be half. Okay, so I should be taking omega-3s then, but just at a low dose? Again, it's not quite that simple, because with any supplement and any drug, even natural supplements, there's always a risk of potential adverse effects, of potential side effects. So we always want to be looking at risk-benefit, because maybe a certain dose does raise risk of atrial fibrillation, but it lowers the risk of a bunch of other stuff. Maybe the net effect is positive. So we always want to be looking at that. And in fact, in the trials that we have looking at omega-3 supplements, in general, the evidence is strongest for higher doses. For example, there's a large trial called Reduce It. You may have heard that name. Basically, they looked at a high-risk population, people with established diagnosed cardiovascular disease or who had a lot of risk factors, including diabetes, and who also had high triglycerides. And they found that a high dose of omega-3s, almost 4 grams a day, very high dose, reduced the risk of cardiovascular outcomes, things like heart attacks and strokes. And it also reduced the number of cardiovascular deaths total. On the other hand, they did find a higher risk of atrial fibrillation in the folks receiving the omega-3 supplement. Just to give you an idea, over the course of the trial, which was about 5 years, the supplement prevented a cardiovascular outcome like heart attacks or strokes in 196 people, and it caused atrial fibrillation in 40 people. So it's an almost fivefold benefit to risk. And that's not even counting the fact that total cardiovascular deaths were lower on the supplement. So clearly, for this population, it was a net positive. But you can see how this is a case-by-case, educated choice, and something that people want to discuss with their doctor and weigh all the pros and cons. So in patients at high cardiovascular risk, most cardiology associations, both in the US and in Europe, recommend high-dose omega-3s. Again, just to clarify, this is a high-risk population, people who already have diagnosed cardiovascular disease or who have a lot of risk factors, who have high triglycerides. They've been given all the basic advice, all the healthy diet and exercise. They're usually on a statin already to lower their LDL cholesterol, so that's already low, but their triglycerides are still high, and that's where there's indication for high-dose omega-3. And this is a prescription-grade formulation. It's not an over-the-counter pill. And by the way, what's usually recommended is purified EPA, just EPA, not the mix of EPA, DHA, because in most trials that we have for these high-risk population, the EPA alone looks a little better. Okay, so that's a pretty specific population, people at very high risk. What about everybody else? There's another trial called VITAL, very large trial, over 25,000 participants. And it looked at people who didn't have cardiovascular disease. They have some risk factors, a little overweight, on blood pressure lowering meds. So kind of your typical Westerner, but no established cardiovascular disease. And they gave them a lower dose of omega-3s, 840 milligrams per day. So that's less than a quarter of what they got in Reduce It, the high risk population. And in VITAL, they used the combination of EPA, DHA. So the main result in VITAL, the main outcome they were looking for was kind of overall cardiovascular risk. And there was no significant difference, no significant effect of the omega-3 supplement. Then they had some other metrics they were looking at, what we call secondary outcomes. For example, risk of heart attacks, myocardial infarctions was significantly lower in the population receiving the omega-3 supplement. Now, we have to be a little cautious with secondary outcomes for statistical reasons, for trial design reasons. But this trial, VITAL, suggests that omega-3 supplements might provide some benefit, even at a much lower dose, and even in people who are not at very high risk. Okay, what about atrial fibrillation, though? Was that increased in VITAL? They did not detect a statistically significant increase in risk of atrial fibrillation on the omega-3 supplement, which is reassuring. And again, aligns with this idea that the dose matters and lower doses are a bit safer, less side effects. Now, when we talk about omega-3s, obviously one consideration is diet, because of course we can get omega-3s, including long-chain omega-3s, from our food. And the main sources of long-chain omega-3s are fish, especially fatty fish, seafood, and also algae. But Westerners typically eat very low amounts of long-chain omega-3s because fish intake is low, algae intake is even lower. And so a valid question is, are these results just because the supplement is kind of filling that gap that people aren't getting enough omega-3s from their diet? And there is some support for this idea. Very interesting finding in VITAL, the effect of omega-3 supplements on cardiovascular risk depended on how much fish people normally ate. So people who ate a lower amount, under 1.5 servings of fish average a week, they benefited from the omega-3 supplements. They had lower cardiovascular risk on the supplement. But people who ate more fish, 1.5 servings or more, they saw no significant benefit of the supplement. So it is possible that for people who are not at very high cardiovascular risk and who get enough EPA, DHA from their food, for example, by eating fatty fish a couple times a week, as it's often recommended, that adding a pill on top might provide no extra benefit. Whereas for people who don't get enough in their diet, the pill might help. And then for people with very high cardiovascular risk, an even higher dose of omega-3s might provide benefit. Now, of course, there's also lots of people who don't eat fish or seafood for different reasons, personal preference, they don't like it, or they have allergies or ethics or whatever it may be. I avoid fish and seafood vast majority of the time because of the environmental impact, for example. So it is possible for this group of people who can't or won't eat sources of long-chain omega-3s that taking it from a supplement might provide some benefit. The evidence is not a slam dunk like we covered, but there's a possibility. And I would especially mind this source of long-chain omega-3s in the context of pregnant women and small children, young children, because of brain development. And of course, people who can't or won't eat fish might also not be interested in the fish oil because it's the same product at the end of the day. They might have the same limitations. So in those cases, an algae oil or the algae directly are an option. Unfortunately, as you might expect, we have a lot less data on algae oil. All of these large cardiovascular trials we've been talking about use fish oil or fish oil-based product. It's just more common. But we do know that algae oil is absorbed and it raises the levels of DHA, for example, in the plasma, just as well as getting it from fatty fish. So I'll sometimes take an omega-3 supplement from algae. I'm not religious about it. Sometimes I forget because, like I said, the evidence is not super strong. Also, people ask if I have a favorite brand. I don't, and I don't sell omega-3 supplements or any other supplements, so I don't really have a horse in the race. So to summarize, basically three buckets you might find yourself in. First bucket, people who don't have very high cardiovascular risk and who eat a healthy, diverse diet containing fatty fish a couple times a week or so. I've seen no evidence that fish oil helps in that population. And then second bucket, people who don't get enough in their food for some reason. A lower dose, 500 to 800 or 900 milligrams a day, that ballpark. It's possible that it provides some benefit, not a very high degree of certainty there, but also lower risk of adverse effects like atrial fibrillation. And again, I would be especially mindful in the case of pregnant women and small children. And finally, third bucket, people with high cardiovascular risk who have cardiovascular disease already or who have a lot of risk factors. A high-dose EPA has compelling evidence behind it, these large randomized trials. On the other hand, the risk of atrial fibrillation is also higher for high-dose omega-3s. So that's something that needs to be worked on case by case, factoring in each individual's risk of developing atrial fibrillation as well, being aware of this trade-off when you work with your doctor and making those informed decisions. Here's a lot more on omega-3s and algae oil, this video right here. And for questions about fish contaminants like mercury and PCBs and all that, check out this video down here. I'll see you over there. Take care.